Welcome to La Parguera. These are the red mangroves right behind me here and all around us here. These are beautiful little ecosystems here in southwestern Puerto Rico. What we're going to do is we're going to go explore the perimeter of this little mangrove island. We got to put on our snorkels and kind of just do a survey. We're basically just going to hug this archipelago of mangroves that kind of goes along the southwestern border of the island.
For the last 7 years, I've been coming to the same mangrove patches to document the biodiversity and environmental conditions over time. In that time, I've learned that not only are these mangroves absolutely beautiful, but they're also vital for this ecosystem and to the island of Puerto Rico itself.
Mangroves is where everything begins. If you go, for example, snorkeling through the mangrove canals, you will see thousands of fish life and all kinds of crabs, everything very tiny, so because they get protected there.
A lot of fish use all of these ecosystems through their phase of life, their life cycle. So as juveniles, like the really important ones, like the groupers, will use the mangrove roots and seagrasses as a recruitment area or a juvenile area. And then when they get bigger, then they migrate to the coral reefs. So they're all interconnected.
Mangroves and fish populations are so intertwined that the loss of just 1 square mile of mangrove forest will result in losing 275,000 pounds of fish per year. That's the weight of 68 cars. Mangroves are where fish grow up, and without them, they would have nowhere to hide. Unfortunately, the global rate of mangrove loss is 3 to 5 times greater than the overall rates of global forest loss. And over a quarter of the world's original mangrove cover is already gone. Mangroves are being cut down for agriculture, aquaculture, and other forms of development.
The locals, we're really concerned about the natural resources. It is the main attraction of a place like this. If you don't have natural resources, then people will come just for the beer and the restaurants.
I was born in India, in Ahmedabad, Gujarat. My parents moved us to Richmond, Virginia. My formative memories are terrible experiences in society, because people make fun of you because you can't speak the language, or you have an accent, or you don't know what certain things are. But what was cool is when we went camping, everyone was nice. You know, when we went camping, like being out in nature with the family was great. You know, and then so it made me want to really, really explore that a little bit more as a kid. There are two things in southwestern Puerto Rico that I feel compelled to share with all my friends. First is the mangroves, the red mangroves, which are right off the coast of La Parguera, southwest Puerto Rico. And then the other is the elkhorn coral, which is on the western side of the island in Rincon.
Okay. So our local marine reserve is the Tres Palmas Marine Reserve, and it's basically like the backyard of Rincon. It attracts a lot of tourism to this part of the island. Like, people are coming here for Steps Beach, which is part of the marine reserve.
Up until about the mid to late 1990s, the elkhorn coral was the main reef-building coral we had here in the Caribbean, South Atlantic and the Caribbean. But there was epizootic disease that wiped out about 90% of the population. You know, if you lose 90% of what is building the reefs, or has been over the last 10,000 years, it takes a huge toll on a lot of the other organisms. Having that three-dimensional structure of when you're small being in the mangroves and then migrating out into the reef habitat, having that elkhorn and reef environment, a place to hide, a place to escape predation, is extremely important.
...155 miles an hour.
The entire island is destroyed.
An expression in Spanish, una navaja de doble filo, it's like there's two sides of it. They made us go closer. That's the part I liked about Hurricane Maria. But of course, the bad part are the old death that came with it, or the destruction, the blackouts, all the problems with health, with food, with water.
Because nobody's come around. It's only been us.
Puerto Rico was an incredible unsung success.
We are dying here.
Unsung success.
It took us more than a year to stand up again and work again and put everything in order. And it still is. There's still a lot of people with the effect of Maria.
This community in La Perguera was had some protection because they have, you know, mangrove canals and these reefs out here that and seagrasses that all dissipate wave energy.
You'll notice just in your if you're in a small boat kind of driving in between the mangroves versus being on the outside of the mangroves that they really do reduce the amount of wind that kind of comes through the area. And that's really important in terms of having hurricanes come through or storms come through. The mangroves are critical to protecting the coastal environment there.
It helped the houses, the boats, big boats. What we do is we just put them inside the mangrove canals and the 3-4 anchors, automatic burst pumps, and the mangroves do the rest. I get up, open doors a month after the hurricane, and then all the merchants have had the opportunity to work, you know, in the middle of that situation.
How long does it take for those corals and those reefs and those mangroves to form? A long time. It's going to take one cruise liner to wipe all of them out. It's going to take one dock for one cruise liner to wipe all of them out.
Everybody wants to have a spear gun and do the lessons and go and spear fish. We changed that many, many years ago. We just do a recreational diving. Biggest, deadliest weapon can be a camera. We understood that was worth 100 times than to kill a fish.
I've just been coming here since I was about 7 or 8. We would come out in boats here. We would do a lot of fishing, but it was very, very pristine, even in the channels over there.
Now, all of a sudden, all of you, all these boats that come, because before the tourism, stayed in San Juan, in the hotels, they wouldn't go out. Now the young people, like you, like to come through the island, which is great.
I don't think the information of biodiversity and how important these ecosystems are, I don't think there's a connection there. I think that's lost with some of the, not all, but with some of the people that do come and enjoy these resources.
I'm just saying, make sure that these beautiful areas are not impacted because we're dependent on them for actually our livelihood. Puerto Rico depends a lot of on tourism.
Como fantasma, fantasma.
there's this thing called shifting baselines, and it was a fisheries term in how, like, our generation, you know, looks at our natural resources that we have now and thinks that this is the good, this is where we can't have anything go, you know, worse than what we have now. The generation before us would be like, nah, what we have now is not anything like what it used to be. And then the generation before that can say the exact same thing. So what we might perceive as like a healthy ecosystem or a healthy environment certainly may not have been the case a generation ago. Now what we've seen, which this is kind of a trend that, you know, that we see throughout the Caribbean, is a reduction in large fish and kind of an overabundance of tiny, small, little fish. And that really drives kind of the evolution of smaller fish growing to like a reproductive size at a much smaller size. So they'll start reproducing when they're smaller, so that what you have now is a population of a bunch of really tiny fish. And it's been shown in research that those smaller fish are not producing as many eggs, they're not producing as fertile eggs, so you're not sustaining your population as well as you would if you had the larger fish.
Mangroves are nursery habitats for fish, but then those fish eventually migrate to the reefs. Well, as they're migrating, that's a source of connectivity. You know, they're changing the environment, they're eating, they're defecating, they're transferring energy as they move. They use these different ecosystems through different stages or, mm-hmm. you know, or parts of their life cycle. And if you took away one of those, then the whole system would shut down.
These mangroves that we're coming here to document are some of the most remarkable living things on Earth. They are a keystone species. They provide a nursery habitat for fish, they protect the coast from storms, and they store more carbon dioxide than tropical rainforests. This means that mangrove forests are and will remain vital to us as we address climate change. And this applies to more than just mangroves. If you're not in the tropics, check to see if you have a salt marsh or a wetland nearby. Just like mangroves, salt marshes and seagrasses support thousands of species and actively take carbon out of the atmosphere, storing it either in their biomass or in the soil. But at current conservation rates, 30 to 40% of tidal marshes and seagrasses and nearly 100% of mangroves could be lost in the next century.
The story of where we are right now is as convoluted and mired as those mangrove roots. You know, it's tangled. We have a lot of work to do to untangle it. Flying here was a very environmentally destructive process. Renting a car and driving all over the island is an environmentally destructive process. That's the strange balance. You know, you can't move forward without taking 8 steps back, it feels, you know? But I don't see it as a conflict. I see it as an ever-evolving story. You know, again, 20 years ago, our conservationist friends didn't have access to smartphones. Now they do. How are they using it? I hope they're using it towards their benefit, you know? So for me, I feel compelled to kind of saying like, okay, well, now that we have this technology, what do we do with it? What can I do with it? What can a person that just has a physical body and the willingness, what can I do?
Citizen science is getting your community involved with research, getting your community involved with monitoring, with outreach. It's great to do science for the sake of doing science, but you know, to do this work and be able to draw your community into it and have them help you with it, I think is really why we're here.
You know, some of these people that are coming from the outside are not just coming to enjoy the beautiful beaches here. They actually want to participate in some of these projects and raise awareness of what is happening in Puerto Rico, put a voice to Puerto Rico, because I think there's a gap in knowledge of what is occurring here in Puerto Rico and what they're saying over in the United States, what's happening.
Look up a local organization that might be able to do more than just point at something and tell you what it is. Don't just come and consume and use and leave and say, oh, it was a great time, I got a couple pictures. give back a little bit to those places that are giving you such like a great time that you're going to remember for the rest of your life.
The marine ecosystems are so valuable to Earth. Life as we know it on Earth is possible because of our marine ecosystems, right? So that's the biggest statement that anyone could ever make about why it matters to us, because it's why we're here.
You can get involved by finding a wetland close to your home. After all, they too require the same monitoring and care, just like these precious ecosystems in southwestern Puerto Rico.